So, the overview of this presentation is an introduction to timing analysis, then hazards in combination circuits, then flip-flop based timing, and then frequency of very basics. Only today we discuss what is the importance of timing in digital design, and what are the issues hazard causes in combination circuits. Then when we design synchronous circuits based on flop, what are the timing parameters we need to encounter. So all those basics digital timing fundamentals will be discussed in this session. So as of we all of we know, digital circuits basically work with respect to a clock. Most of the designs are synchronous with respect to clock. So clock is like our heart. So clock should beat properly, or clock should run properly. So any small issue related to the clock may cause entire system malfunction, and finally we may not able to rectify what kind of problem we are getting. So designing the timing and clock related circuits are very critical when we consider in digital system design. So clocks, as I mentioned, is like our heart. So any small variation in clock may cause unwanted malfunctions in the circuit, and those kind of malfunctions are very difficult to detect. It may take days for us to debug, and finally why this kind of issues are coming. May take long time to debug these kind of problems when the clocks are not proper. Similarly, when we design an IC also, chip also, if you design the chip, finally we say how the circuit is functioning at say 200 megahertz or 1 gigahertz, we close the timing of the IC. But finally, when it is fabricated and testing on the board, actual real system, we may not get that frequency of operation. So that is because the timing analysis has not done properly. So though if you do the timing analysis properly, then the chip or circuit will operate the required frequency. So timing analysis is the most important part. So in VLSI, there is a stream for timing analysis called static timing analysis. So mostly people do static timing analysis. But the dynamic timing analysis is more critical. We need to generate a lot of test vectors and check the timing analysis. So most of the time people do static timing analysis only, and close the timing of the circuit. So timing analysis is that's what. So most of the timing analysis static only. So here we discuss only the basics, the very fundamentals of timing related issues in digital circuits. So we discuss about the hazards in combination circuits. So timings are important in combination circuits as well. Then flop based timing, what are the timing parameters in flops? Then finally the frequency of operation of a synchronous circuit, digital circuits, how to derive the frequency of operation, at what frequency the circuit would work. So all those kind of few examples we see. So now we come to the hazards in combinational circuits. So most of the time when we design the combination circuit, we may not see the timing basically. Similarly, when we optimize a circuit, whether the optimization may cause a hazard or not, that also we may not see. And we just optimize it and see the functionality is fine. And if functionality is fine, okay, we fix the circuit. But that circuit may not be hazard free. So hazards may cause in that circuit, and that may cause unwanted behavior of the circuit finally. So now let's see few examples of hazards and what is a hazard and a few examples of hazards. So if you see a hazard in a combo circuit may produce a glitch basically. So a glitch is an unwanted spike. So you can see this glitch, an unwanted spike. Say the output is say at static 0 or static 1, and an unwanted spike is causing at the output or in between some intermediate signals, that will cause a glitch. So a glitch is an unwanted spike. So glitches will generate unwanted high frequency components and spoil the circuit behavior. So if you see the analysis spike, so we need to basically analyze the Fourier transform. If you see the Fourier transform of a pulse, if you see a simple pulse, in time domain, I think most of you are familiar with the Fourier analysis. So in time domain, if we have a pulse, the frequency domain of the same is a sinc function. So how a sinc function will look like? We have say main lobe and side lobes for sinc function. So if you see, if you recall the Fourier transform of a rectangular pulse, then the rectangular pulse will have many frequency the time frequency domain of the rectangular pulse will have many frequency components. It's a sinc function. So like this sinc function. And as the time domain compresses, compression in time domain causes compression in time domain causes expansion in frequency domain. So as far as the spike or the pulse width is narrow, we will be getting a, so if pulse width is very narrow in time domain, we will be getting a flat frequency domain. That means many frequency components would be there in a spike. So a glitch is very dangerous because a glitch is very small frequency component, a narrow width pulse. So if time domain a spike is coming, the frequency domain we see a flat response. So many frequency components would be there. So that will cause unwanted radiation and finally the circuit may not function properly. So those kind of issues will be there if glitches are coming in the combo circuit. So while designing a combinational circuits also, we need to minimize the chances of glitches. So whenever a data toggling is happening, because of that there shouldn't be any unwanted glitch or spike at the output or any intermediate signal of our design. So that's what. So glitches are very dangerous because it will generate unwanted frequency components and the radiations, EMIMC point of view, all point of view, that would be an issue. Circuit may malfunction. So we have hazards in combo circuits. Various hazards are there. One is called the static zero hazard. So static zero hazard means the signal is static at zero, but an unwanted spike is coming to one. So that is called static zero. And static one is output or signal should be static at one and unwanted spike, a high to low transition is happening. So that is called static one hazard. And dynamic hazard means signal transitions in between. So high to low and low to high transitions are happening. That is dynamic hazard. Signal is changing up or down. That is called dynamic. So these kind of hazards shouldn't be there in circuit design when we design a circuit. So one is static zero hazard, another is static one hazard, and other is dynamic hazard. So we shall see few examples. So you can see the static zero hazard. Suppose an input x, say input is x and output is y, and an input x is changing from 1 to 0. So when it is changing from 0 to 1, not 1 to 0, when it is a In this example, suppose x is changing from 0 to 1. So while drawing the timing, we need to consider the gate delay. So that is the gate delay or combinational delay we need to consider while drawing the timing. So if you see the timing of this circuit, so suppose x is changing from say 0 to 1, then we need to the output of the inverter, we need to encounter the inverter delay. So it will change from say 1 to 0 after the inverter delay. So once it is changing from 1 to 0 after the inverter delay, similarly, the AND gate output, what happens if you see the AND gate output? The output should be actually should be at 0, but if you see at this point, so x is changing from 0 to 1 here at say point 1, and at point 2 only, second point, the inverter output is changing from 1 to 0. So at this time, both inputs are now 1 for as the inverter is concerned. So after the AND gate delay, say it is this same delay, gate delay, output here it would be high for some time. Then both are at this point, both are again this input is low. So we know AND gate one input is low means output will be low, then it will continue to be low. So this will cause a static zero hazard. That means signal is static and an unwanted spike from 0 to 1 is occurring. So that's how. I hope this timing is clear. So when we draw the timing, we need to consider the combinational or gate delay as well. So when x is changing from 0 to 1, after the inverter delay, the inverter output would toggle from 1 to 0. So due to this inverter delay, there is a overlap between x and x bar as 1. So due to that overlap, the AND gate output would be, the AND gate would sample these two inputs and the output would be 1 for a small duration of time. That means the inverter delay, that much of duration of time, the AND gate output would be 1. So actually we expect output is 0 in this kind of circuit. So x bar comes means we actually expect output should be 0, but due to the gate delay, there is a transition from 0 to 1. So x bar, AA bar, when we encounter finally at the final stage of a design, if AA bar or YY bar encounters, then there would be chances of hazards that we need to see. We expect it is 0, but when we design the circuit, there would be chances of hazard. Similarly, static 1 hazard is a reverse output we expect in case of an OR gate, x plus x bar. If you see the circuit, x plus x bar, if we expect output to be at static 1, but because of the gate delay, say inverter delay, when we draw the timing for this by encountering the inverter and OR gate delay, when x is changing from, in this case is a reverse case, when x is changing from 1 to 0, so after the inverter delay only, the inverter output would toggle from 0 to 1. So hence the input x as well as the x bar, there would be a small overlap of 0. So both are 0, output of the OR gate is 0. But this is an unwanted transition. We are, as per our Boolean algebra, we should get x plus x bar or a plus a bar equal to 1. But here we are getting a transition from 1 to 0. So this is called a static one hazard. That means signal is static. We expect signal is static only at one, but an unwanted glitch is coming because of the combinational delay or gate delay. So when we are drawing this, so we need to practice by drawing the timing of the combo circuits as well. Means we need to encounter all the timing of the gates as well when we are designing the circuit. So now let's see a simple example. Say this is my design requirement. I have three inputs, say A, B, C, and an output Y. So when input are the, so we start the design of a combo circuit with the truth table. Then we expand the truth table if required. Then based on that truth table expansion, we make the K-map. Then once we make the K-map, we do the grouping to optimize the design. And once it is grouped, we form the Boolean expression or sum of product or product of some form. So we see a SOP form example here. So this is the requirement for me. Say A, B are 0, 0 means output is 0. 0, 1 means input is C. And 10 means C bar and 11 means 1. So this is a truth table requirement. So A and B and C are the inputs. So next stage would be we need to expand the truth table. So once the truth table is given, so A, B are 0, 0. Next we need to expand this by A, B, C. So we need to give the values for C as well. So A and B are 0, 0 means C can take the value 0 and 1. But irrespective of C, as per the truth table, output is Y. So like this, we need to expand. Then 0, 1, C can take 0, 1. So if A and B are 0, 1, output is C. So 0, 1. Then 1, 0. C01 means it is toggling C bar. So C is 0, 1, 1, 0. And what are 1, 1? Output is 1, 1 irrespective of C. So like this, we need to expand the truth table. So that is how the conventional design method we follow. So once truth table is expanded, next step is we need to optimize. Or I directly we can write the expression for Y. Say A bar B C plus A B bar C bar plus A, B, C bar plus A, B, C. So directly we can write the expression. Then we can do the Boolean optimization. Instead, directly we can go with the K-map simplification and perform the Boolean optimization. So if you see this circuit, we can form the K-map like this, and we can group say B, C, and we can group these two inputs. So we will be getting the output Y as B, C plus A, C bar, BC plus AC bar. So BC plus AC bar. So here this should be B and this should be A. So like this, we can get the expression. So once design is completed, next, we need to do the timing analysis of this. So if you analyze the circuit behavior, say A is equal to 1, B is equal to 1, and C is toggling from 1 to 0. You can see the timing of this. You can just note down. So C is, we are assuming A and B are 1. And C is changing from, say, 1 to 0. So if C is changing from 1 to 0, then after T inverter time, C bar would toggle from 0 to 1. You can just analyze. Then A1, since A and B are 1, A1 output would be changing from 1 to 0 after T AND gate. And you can see the A2 output. A2 output would be changing from 0 to 1 after T AND gate 2. So that is because there is an inverter delay. So C, assume C is changing from 0 to 1, 1 to 0. Then after T inverter delay, C bar would change from, say, 0 to 1. So we need to, this is digital circuit. So we should not assume the circuits are operating sequentially. Here all the gates are operating in concurrent manner. So whenever any input changes, immediately the output would reflect. So here A and C, or assume A is 1, so B, no issue. So C is changing here. So since C is changing here from 1 to 0, since we are assuming A and C are, A is equal to 1, so whatever C change will propagate to A1 immediately. So that is why A1 output after AND gate delay, immediately it is changing from 1 to 0. Next, A2 delay, B is, for this input is stuck at 1 only. So since C is changing here from 1 to 0, the inverter output would toggle from 0 to 1 after T inverter delay. Hence, the AND gate output also would toggle from 0 to 1. After the AND gate delay. So this point only the inverter output has toggled from 0 to 1. Then after that AND gate delay, second output A2 would toggle from 0 to 1. So now if we see this point A1 is low here, this point A2 is low here, and because of this overlap of low, output would be here, a low would come. After that, again, output would be toggling to 1. So a dip or spike is happening from 1 to 0. A static 1 hazard is happening. So you can just analyze the timing. So you need to draw the timing and practice. Then only it will come. So digital designing the circuit alone will not do. Once we design, so here what we did, we based on the input requirement, input based on the CAM map requirement, based on the two table requirement, we expanded the two table, then optimization we performed the CAM map, then circuit is derived. So once we derived the circuit, functional wise, if you see, it is fine. But for certain input conditions, say A is equal to 1, B is equal to 1, and the input is toggling from 1 to 0, then there is a hazard. This is called one corner case scenario. So one scenario is happening here, corner case scenario is happening here, means unexpected, some this kind of input combination, there is a chance or there is a hazard in this circuit. So this hazard, as I mentioned, if sudden spike, this kind of spikes comes, that will spoil our entire our circuit. So the circuit should be hazard free. So you can just draw the timing and practice for this. So each and every, so you need to, once you are drawing the timing, keep in mind the this is hardware, so all the gates would operate in parallel, means concurrently we need to analyze, not sequentially, not one by one you need to analyze. All the gates will operate in parallel, so whenever any change is happening at the input of that gate, immediately the output will reflect. So easily we can analyze the this kind of static one hazard by looking the condition, say A is equal to 1, B is equal to 1, the output A1 would be say C, so C will be propagating when AND gate input is 1, the C would be propagating, so we will be getting a C here and a C bar here, say A1 is equal to C, A2 is equal to C bar and Y is equal to C plus C bar. So that means, as I mentioned earlier circuit, as per our earlier circuit analysis, if we are getting a this kind of say X plus X bar is coming, we will be getting a static one hazard. Similarly, X into X bar is coming, we will be getting a static zero hazard. So that way, once we derive a circuit, then we need to see the input condition. So any chances of say C plus C bar is occurring at the output, propagation is happening at the output for certain input conditions, then there is a chance of static one hazard in the circuit. So we need to mask those kind of hazards. Otherwise, as I mentioned, our circuit may not work properly. It will be very difficult for us to detect these kind of malfunctions once the design is freezed and then once we fabricate it or ASIC or chip. Or FPGA also, a design is freezed on FPGA also. So easily you can find out is the chances of hazard once the circuit is finalized. So now what we do to clear this hazard or to mask this hazard? Say masking static one hazard by adding an AND gate, we need to add. AND gate output stays high across 1 to 0, 0 to 1 transition. So this AND gate output B, A, B, if you are adding. So what we need to do is, from a point of view, if you are seeing this kind of, say, grouping, if you see, actually for optimization point of view, we need to group only this and this. But we can group these two as well. This will not affect the functionality. But thing is, it will add a redundant extra hardware. Functionally, if you see the Boolean expression, this is optimized expression, it is fine. But if you group these two as well, it won't affect the functionality, but it will mask the unwanted hazards. So masking static one hazard by adding an AND gate in this case, AND gate output stays across 1 to 0 and 0 to 1 transition. So A and B are 1. Then whatever C is changing 1 to 0, 0 to 1 transition, no issue. The output would be 1. So the Y output would stay at 1. There won't be any unwanted glitch or transition at the output. So while we design a combination circuit, we need to see these kind of issues. And in CAM apps, if we miss, for optimization point of view, if suppose we miss this kind of grouping, we may get an hazard in the circuit. So that should be very carefully we need to do while designing a circuit. Similarly, next comes the static zero hazard. So we saw and or circuit forms basically a static one hazard, and in this case of static zero, or and circuit will form a static zero hazard, and we need to optimize in terms of POS form. That when we do most of POS form of CAM apps, same way we need to group the unwanted so if we see this circuit also, assume in this case, so earlier case we analyze like A and B are zero, so one. So in this case we need to analyze the reverse manner: A is equal to zero, B is equal to zero, and C is toggling from zero to one. So same way you can draw the timing. So C is changing from zero to one, immediately the C bar output would be changing from one to zero. So A plus C, since C is changing from 1 to 0, immediately 0 to 1, immediately A plus C, this AND first OR gate output would be A plus C would be immediately high after the OR gate delay, and B plus C bar would be low after the gate delay, the inverter delay followed by the OR gate delay. Then there is an overlap of say 1, A plus C and B plus C bar. So instead of expecting output at static 0, there would be a spike, a static zero hazard occurs. So you can see in this case output would propagate. So A is equal to zero, output would be C in case of first OR gate, and B is equal to zero, output would be C bar in case of second OR gate, and now output is Y is nothing but C dot C bar. So C dot C bar means always we expect output is zero, but in this case there is a hazard due to the inverter delay. So that way we can analyze the chances of static zero as well as static one hazard conditions in combinational circuit. So as I mentioned, hazards are very dangerous. We need to avoid these kind of hazards. So next, we will be coming into timing in flip-flops. So when we design a combo circuit, we need to consider the combinational delay. So if you consider the combinational delay.
Hello. I have one question here. So when you say we have to avoid the hazards in the design, right? But because the design will have millions of combination circuits, like millions of gates.
Yeah.
We cannot analyze each and everything, right? So that is there any STA tool will do this kind of like extra gate insertions?
No, that synthesis itself, it will take care. Actually, optimization point of view, the tool will take care. STA will not do the hazard actually.
Okay.
So this synthesis tool like Synopsys DC, Cadence and Counter all are powerful actually. So that's how the tools powerful. So they optimize in such a way that the hazard condition should not occur.
Okay. So this synthesis tools, they deal only with combinational hazards and only in combination circuits?
Yeah, combination optimization. No, they have combinational path optimization basically.
Okay.
Because flops anyway we need to add, or for pipelining point of view, we may have to split the flop. So synthesis tool will try to do the maximum combo path optimization. Still it is problem, then we have to do our like pipelining, all those manual optimization.
Oh.
That way.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
So we come to next, the timing in flops. So flops, if you see, The most important timing is the propagation delay, one timing. So when we consider, say, this is a D flop, let's start with a D flop. So there is a clock and data input D, and assume D is sampling, say, at this launching edge, and after TPD, we get the output Q. So propagation delay of the flop. So when we draw the timing of any flops based designs, we need to consider this kind of propagation delay, TPD, of the flop. So most of the time we draw timing same at the signal transition at the same edge, so that may cause finally some timing issues or timing mismatch. So whenever we draw the flop timing, see launching edge at passage of clock or negates, whatever, the data is sampled, and after TPD, output is Q. So propagation delay of the clock. So next important is the setup time and hold time. So setup time, as shown in the timing diagram, before the passage of clock, the input should be stable, say, certain time before the passage of clock. This is called setup time. Similarly, after the passage of clock, input should be stable for certain time. So before passage of clock, for certain time, input should be stable. So that time is called the setup time, and after passage of clock, the input should be stable for certain time. That time is called the hold time. So setup and hold. So these timings are coming because of the internal capacitance start delays of the flops. So you can analyze a flop circuit by designed by using inverters. So basically, in all these kind of CMOS libraries, the flops are designed by using inverters only, because inverters are known as the nucleus of CMOS technology. So there is a book called Jan M. Rabe. So in Jan M. Rabe, you can learn the inverter characteristics, basically transfer characteristics, to learn about the input output timing of inverter, how it behaves. So when we analyze, you can understand why the delay is required basically. So setup time and hold time. So three timing most important if we consider for flops. One is the TPD, propagation delay of the flop. So that is moment the data is sampled, say, with reference to the passage or negates. Then after that, the output, the time taken to generate or get the output is called the TPD. Then the setup time, that means the input should be stable before the passage of clock for some time, that is called the setup time. And after the passage of clock, input should be stable for certain time, that is called the hold time. So setup and hold time. So TPD, setup time, hold time. So now if you see a simple flop, assume input is satisfying the setup and hold, what frequency we can give to the clock, say 100 megahertz or 1 gigahertz, or what frequency we can give. So we need to draw the timing for that and analyze. So if you see the clock, the flop D and Q, and we have the clock. So when we see the timing, setup should satisfy. So assume input is satisfying the setup. So T setup, T hold. Then next edge can come after the T setup. So this T hold and this T setup. So I repeat, when we draw the timing, we need to see the setup and hold. Set percentage of clock, T setup and T hold. So assume that D, input D is satisfying. Suppose D is not toggling very fast, then the flop output will encounter into the timing violations, because setup and hold times are fixed by the technology library vendors. So we cannot change the setup and hold time of the flop. So if you are assuming the input is toggling within the setup and hold time window, then if you draw the timing, say T setup and T hold. So after input is sampled, say at this point, after input should be stable up to T hold, then it can change. After T hold, it can change and should satisfy the setup. So next edge can come after the setup. So no issue. So in this case, no issue if you draw the timing. So we can reduce the clock edge or clock period this way. So the maximum frequency, we can give the frequency of single flop, say up to T setup plus T hold. So that way we need to analyze. So now we consider, next let's see a simple next circuit. What should be the frequency of this? So how to draw the timing and the frequency of this circuit? So two flops are cascaded and the clock is common. It's a synchronous circuit. Clock is common to both flops and input X is given. Say assume, as I mentioned, let's assume X is satisfying the setup and hold window of the first flop or D0. Then Q0 is connected to D1 and finally output is Q1. So how to draw the timing and frequency of this flop? So in this case, say so we have two flops now connected and a common clock, input D, D0, Q0, D1, Q1. Clock is common. This is X and this is Y. So as I mentioned, we need to draw the TPD also. While drawing the timing, we need to encounter the TPD also, propagation delay. So I assume X is changing, say like this. This is X input. And at percentage of clock, X is sampled as high. So now, as I mentioned, this is hardware. So both flops will operate concurrently. Clock is common to both flops and assume all the flops are, both flops are cleared initially. That means Q0 and Q1 is zero and X is now changing 0 to 1 and it is satisfying the setup and hold time window. Let's assume. So now at this passage, let's sample the X. X would be sampled by the flop and the first flop, D0 flop, then it will be sampled by D0 and after TPD output would go high. Q0 will go high. So now both flops are operating in parallel. So initially I said Q0 and Q1 was initialized to zero. So since Q0 is zero here, this edge, the second flop would be sampling Q0. That is nothing but D1. So output would be Q1 or Y would be zero here, because here Q0 or D1 is zero. Q0 is equal to D1. Then next POSITCH, again both flops are sampling together the inputs. So Q0 is, or D1 is zero here, and X is zero, or D0 is zero. So after TPD, this output goes low. But here D1 or Q0 is high. So after TPD, output goes high. And next POSITCH, if you see, input here, Q0 is zero, and output would go to low after TPD. So that's what delay flop. D flop means delay flop. So here, if you see, two flops are cascaded, so there won't be a one clock delay here. If you see, there won't be a one clock delay. So here after TPD only, input would be, output of the first flop would be toggled. Similarly, after one clock only, second flop output will be sampled. Both output won't be toggling together. So while drawing timing, so we need to draw the propagation delay of the flop. That's very, very important. Otherwise, suppose in simulation and all, if you are working in VLSI field, in simulation, most of the time people won't encounter these kind of delays. So RTL to gate level, once we convert RTL gate level, mismatch may happen because of this kind of timing problems. So better always we let's model the flop propagation delay while performing the simulation, also while performing our design simulation, so that there won't be any gate level RTL timing issues, or at circuit level also there won't be any issues. So this is about drawing the timing. So very clearly we need to draw. So we need to draw the timing and practice when you do any design. So now what would be the frequency of operation? So what clock I can give? Clock frequency. What should be the frequency of this? As we saw, single flop means setup and hold time. At least we need to satisfy the setup and hold time window. The clock can, clock edges can change within that window. But now if you see, we have two flops are connected. One flop output is the input of the next, and clock is again common. So now if you see, so we assumed input is X is satisfying the setup and hold time window of the first flop. So once the setup and time hold time window of the first flop is satisfied, then the input would be sampled, and after TPD, we saw the TPD, after TPD, the output is changed. TPD, propagation delay of the flop. So here, this input to this output TPD. So once TPD is satisfied, next, if you see the input of this flop, the input of this flop should satisfy the setup time window of this. So TPD plus T, setup of second flop. So I repeat, X is sampled at passage of clock, and after T PED, the input is transferred to Q0 output. Once the output is ready here, that output or Q0 should satisfy the setup of the second flow D1. So TPD plus T setup of the second flow. Otherwise, suppose this input, this is changing within the setup of this flow output, then this flop output will encounter into timing violations. So it's a problem called metastability. So those kind of timing violations, this so setup violation of this flop will encounter into setup violation. So TPD plus T setup. TPD plus T setup should satisfy. So now let's see an example. What about the hold timer? So similarly, if I am adding one more flop, what happened? So here first this input to this second flop input path, so this second flop input to next third flop input path. So is all the flops are same technology library, means here TPD plus T setup. So let's assume, say, so if you add more flops, conclusion is all the flops will operate, all the path, say here, all will operate in parallel. So TPD plus T setup only is the required clock time period. So 1 by TPD plus T setup is the clock frequency. So now in this case, let's assume, say, TPD is equal to 4 nanosecond, T setup is equal to 4 nanosecond, and T hold is equal to 2 nanosecond. So moment X changes after TPD output, say if you draw the timing, moment X is changing after TPD this is TPD, say 4 nanosecond. Output would change. And second flop input should satisfy another, say 4 nanosecond. So we need to enhance the edge up to minimum up to this 4 nanosecond. Say what should be the 4 nanosecond window required. So this time period is the clock frequency requirement. So what is happening? What happened to the hold? So in this case, the hold, we need, if you see, the input of the second flop should satisfy the hold time requirement. So now, if hold time required is more than TPD, say t hold is equal to 6 nanosecond. Now what happens? We need to analyze the timing in case of t hold is say 6 nanoseconds. Usually hold time would be less than TPD, propagation delay of the flock. That means hold time will fall within the TPD of the flock. But suppose hold time is greater than TPD of the flock. In this case, how to draw the timing? So suppose x is changing, we need to, after TPD, say 4 nanosecond, output is changing. So now if you see the input D1, this flop should hold the input for say 6 nanosecond time with respect to the clock edge. So here after TPD, the input is changing here, but the hold time requirement of the second flop is minimum 6 nanosecond window with respect to the clock. So within this window, if the second flop input is changing, second flop input is changing, again there would be hold time violation issues. So in that scenario, we need to add t hold. So that means we need to consider maximum of TPD comma t hold. So the frequency of operation, if you see, t setup plus maximum of TPD comma t hold. But usually hold time will fall within the propagation delay. So we consider t setup plus t hold. So frequency is equal to 1 by. So you need to analyze this. You can analyze once again the circuit. So the timing you need to draw. Once you draw the timing and analyze, it will come automatically how the setup and how the TPD plus T setup, similarly T hold also coming into picture. We'll see once few more examples, so it will be more clear. So first thing is draw the timing, then analyze with the timing parameters up to what frequency the circuit would operate. So if you add one more flops like this series of flops, the frequency of operation would be same, but input in this case we will be getting the output Y after two clock cycles, but in this case we'll be getting the output after one clock cycles. So that's why delay flop, D flop, one clock cycle delay we get. So here two clock cycle delay we get. So like that, if you add series of shift register, we know we'll be getting n clock cycles, n flops if we add n clock cycle, but frequency would be the same. Frequency of operation would be the same because all the flops are operating in parallel. Next, we see if you introduce a combo circuit in between. So most of the digital designs are synchronous designs. So we have the combo path along with the flops. So flops output would be connected to a combo path. Some external input also will come to the combo path, process it, and generate the next input of the flop. So that way, register to register only the timing paths would come. So this flop input to next flop input. So earlier case we have seen no combo path. Now we have added a combinational logic in between. So this digital circuit would be something like this. Finally, we have the combo circuits as well as the flops. So now what should be the frequency, how to analyze? Say simple, I have added a simple inverter. So now, after input changes X, after TPD, output would be changing, Q0 would be changing. Then there is a combo path here as an inverter. So after inverter delay, input D1 would be activated. So the input D1 should toggle or change with before the setup of the second flop. So I repeat, once X is changed or toggling at the X input, that would be sampled at POSEDGE and that would be transferred to the Q0 after TPD, propagation delay of the flop. Then after the inverter delay or combinational delay, that would be transferred to the input of the second flop. But the input should satisfy the changes or toggling should happen before the setup time window of the second flop. So now again, TPD plus T combo plus T setup of this flop. So again, path is this input to this input. So this flop TPD plus T combo plus T setup. So input is changed at this one clock edge. Next clock edge can come after this TPD, T combo plus T setup of the second flop. So now given TPD is equal to say 4 nanosecond, T inverter is 5 nanosecond, T setup is say 6 nanosecond, hold is 3 nanosecond. If you draw the timing diagram, we need to now consider the, so again you need to practice drawing timing edge. So after TPD of the first flop, then T combo and T setup. So this should change. So if you are giving the edge, clock edge, say after here, suppose I am giving the clock second pause edge here within this T setup window, then setup violation will happen. So I can give only clock edge. So after TPD, then T combo and T setup of the second flop. So that is how the timing. So you can draw the timing diagram also. Assume you can practice by drawing the timing diagram. Say assume X is changing from say 0 to 1. What happened here after TPD? Q would be toggled. Then inverter output would be toggled after the inverter delay, say 5 nanosecond. Then after it toggles, we need to give, there should be a margin of 6 nanosecond to satisfy the setup of the second this flop, second flop, to satisfy the setup of this second flop. So it's a first flop and second flop. So timing path is basically register to register, one flop input to next flop input, always register to register. So in between there would be the combo logic as well in circuits. Earlier we saw there is no combo logic. Now actual circuit when we design, there would be the combo logic as well. So most of the time we can do the combo path optimization to reduce the frequency or improve the frequency of operation, to reduce the time and improve the frequency of operation. Because the setup hold or and TPD are fixed by the technology vendors. So now you analyze this circuit. Let's analyze this circuit. TPD is equal to 2 nanosecond. T inverter is equal to 2 nanosecond. T setup in this case, it is 6 nanosecond and T hold is also 6 nanosecond. So what happens to timing? It's a simple circuit. So TPD is 2 nanosecond. T inverter is 2 nanosecond. T setup and hold is 6 nanosecond. So simple D and Q, and there's an inverter in the combo path and a clock. So assume, as we discussed, assume Q is equal to initially 0 and we have the clock. So moment clock edge comes, since Q is equal to 0, input D would be initially Q bar, so it would be 1. So after TPD, 2 nanosecond, output will toggle to 1. So moment output is toggling to 1, Q is toggling to 1. Again, D was initially high. So this is Q and this is D was initially high. After 2 nanosecond, D again will toggle to low. So I repeat. Say assume Q is equal to initially 0 and say pause edge of clock comes. Q0 means D would be high because it is not of Q. So moment the power surge comes, input. Now D is high, so that is sampled, and after TPD, propagation delay of the flop, say 2 nanosecond, that is transferred to output. So now output Q is high. So moment Q is high, immediately the input again D after 2 nanosecond, because as per our timing, we fixed TPD and T inverter, means this combo delay, TPD is 2 nanosecond, D to Q delay is 2 nanosecond, and inverter delay is also 2 nanosecond. So that means after pause edge of clock, total within 4 nanosecond window, input D will change. But our hold time and setup time, T hold is equal to 6 nanosecond, T setup also 6 nanosecond. So if you see here, the setup requirement is 6 nano hold requirement is 6 nanosecond, and here it is a setup. So setup, of course, we can fix the next edge here, we can give 6 nanosecond, but hold, the input D should not change within the hold window of the flop. But here hold window is 6 nanosecond and setup also 6 nanosecond. So setup we can change the edge, but here hold, how to fix the hold problem, because the input is now changing within the hold window. So you can draw that. This is a very simple circuit. You can draw the timing and practice. Say at pause, say initially, say assume Q is equal to 0. That means D is 1. Set pause, Q is sampled. After TPD, means 2 nanosecond, Q would be toggled from 0 to 1. Then moment Q is toggling, there is an inverter from Q to D path. So that inverter output would toggle back from 1 to 0 after the inverter delay. So now the input D, as per the requirement, setup hold, setup is 6 and hold is 6. So hold time requirement is 6 nanosecond. So the input is changing within the 6 nanosecond window. Now if you see, D is changing within the T hold window, because after the pause edge, input should be maintained for 6 nanosecond. A hold time violation will occur here, violation will happen, hold. So if you change the frequency, we cannot fix in this case the hold violations if you change the frequency. But of course setup we can adjust with the, so this setup is this time window, so this we can adjust with the edge. So edge, if you are giving more edge, means increasing the time period or reducing the frequency, we will be able to fix the setup issue. But here hold issue, now if you change the edge, hold will not be fixing. So that means frequency, if you change, hold issue will not fix here. So now in this scenario, we need to add more delays in the combo path. So say we need to add, say, 2 more inverters. If you add of 2 nanosecond to 2, so 2 nanosecond propagation delay, or delay, assume 2 nanosecond is a propagation delay. If you add 2 more inverters, then what happens to timing? So in that case, here the D would change after, so 2 plus 6 nanosecond only. So that means we are giving enough margin of hold. Or if you add one inverter, one inverter functionality will change. So we need to add 2 more inverters. So functionality also should not change. So we need to add two more inverters so that the hold time violation goes. So that means when there are hold time violations, we need to optimize the data path, not the frequency. So at setup time violation, we can try to fix by, say, we change the edge or we change the frequency of operation. If setup time violations are there, no issue. But when circuits are encountering hold time violations, that is very dangerous than setup time. So we need to solve those kind of setup violation problem. So it's a simple example about the setup and hold time circuit design. So it's a very simple circuit, how to design the timing and draw the timing. So when you get any digital circuit, try to draw the timing. Most of the circuits are synchronous with respect to clock, and there would be combo path as well. So to improve the timing, we need to try to improve the combo path. And if there is any hold violations are there, hold violation should be fixed. Even setup violations are not fixed, we can say our circuit will work at, say, it is causing violations 100 megahertz, it will work at 50 megahertz or 75 or 80 megahertz. But setup time violations are, if frequency change, it may not fix it. So we need to see the setup issue, hold violations, sorry, not setup, hold violations, and trying to fix it. So now let's see one more example of this. Now I have encoded in one more parameter, say, clock skew. What is the clock skew? So here in this example, I have given TPD is say 4 nanosecond. Say inverter delay is 5 nanosecond. Setup time and 6 nanosecond. Hold is say 3 nanosecond. And the skew, clock skew is 3 nanosecond. So what is clock skew? So when we design any digital circuit, clock management is also very critical. So as I mentioned earlier, suppose the clock is not proper, then the design may not work properly. So any jittering in the clock, so we have the clock and clock is shaking. Or any clock skew. So clock skews are basically happening because of the propagation path. So clock is here, assume this is the clock. We assume the source clock is starting at this edge and some portion of circuits are working, say, at this edge, and due to the propagation delay, this edge may be shifted. This is called a skew. So we have negative as well as a positive skew, and clock is edges advanced, that is called a negative. So these kind of skews also would be there in design. So that's what, because clock can reset when we see it is a global signal. So clock is going to all, say we have 1 million gate or 2 million gate design, the clock is going to all the flops. So managing the clock is also very, very critical. Properly, we need to regenerate the clock in between, or clock routing, clock trees, a lot of clock management designs are available. So now in this example, let's see if you encounter the skew. Now clock skew is given 3 nanosecond. What happens to the timing? So TPD say 4 nanosecond, T inverter 5 nanosecond, hold time, setup time is 6, hold time is 3, and the skew is 3 nanosecond. So now if you draw the timing, TPD is 4, TPD is equal to 4, T inverter is 5, setup 6, inverter is 5, T setup is 6, T hold is 3, and T Q is equal to 3. If you draw the timing, so here skew in the sense, suppose the clock, say this is clock 1 and say second clock is clock 2. So clock with respect to clock 1, there is a 3 nanosecond positive skew. That means delayed the second clock flop. Second flop is delayed by 3 nanosecond. So first flop, say the source of the first flop is clock 1, and so that clock 1 is propagating to the via some path to the second flop, and due to that path, that clock is delayed by 3 nanosecond. That is called the, that is also called positive skew. It is delayed. So now if you draw the timing, clock 1, so again input is a X is input is sampled. So after TPD output, then after TPD T combo. So TPD is here, then T combo, then T setup you have to satisfy. So now if we see the second clock is delayed. That means with respect to this edge, first clock edge, the second flop edge is delayed. So as per our timing analysis, timing path is from say flop to flop. So we need to see the setup time window of the second flop. Now, if you see, the clock of the second flop is delayed by 3 nanosecond. So edge is delayed by 3 nanosecond. So we are getting an extra margin of T skew. That is 3 nanosecond extra margin we are getting. So that means I can reduce this clock frequency to this clock period. Say now actual period was T PD plus T inverter delay plus T setup, means 15 nanosecond. Actual period was say 15 nanosecond, means TPD plus T inverter plus T setup. Now I can reduce that to say 12 nanosecond, so that this would be delayed by another 3 nanosecond. So there won't be any setup issue, violation issue by this edge. So that means I can reduce the time period, means we can improve the frequency of operation of the circuit because of this positive delay. That means clock skew is positive. Clock is delayed with respect to the second clock. So if now if it is a negative skew, that means if edge is enhanced, say I am propagating the clock from the other direction. So here I am giving the first clock and second clock. The skew advantage we will not get in that case, because edge will come here first, then only edge will come here. And if there is a negative skew like this here, edge is enhanced, then we have to add that also into our timing path. But positive skew means suppose clock is delayed, we will be getting the advantage. So frequency of operation we can further improve by clock management as well. So combo path we can optimize, and properly managing the clock edges. So some circuits are very time critical, we are not able to fix or optimize, maximally optimize the combo path. Let's do the clock management by clock management circuits. So many clock management circuits based on PLL, DLLs are available. So we can use that. So we can have make a positive skew, negative skew, edge enhancement, all those kind of techniques we can use, and we can improve further the timing. So that is also another technique, clock, proper clock management to improve the timing. So we can just recall simple flop. So propagation delay, TPD, what is the TPD of the flop? Then setup time and hold time. Then what frequency a single flop means. Then when we cascade two flops, what happens? So there is no combo path. Then if you add, so if you cascade many flops, frequency will not change, but output would be timing. You see the output would be delayed by every one by one clock cycles if you add more flops. So more n flops, n clock cycle delay will get in this case. All the flops are operating in parallel. And next, if you add the combo path, frequency will change. And a typical, very simple example, by adding an inverter in combo path, what happens? Then an example of setup time violation. Oh, sorry, hold time violation. So setup time violation, we can change the frequency, but hold time violation, we need to fix it in data path mostly, or we need to do the clock management. Then when there are clock skew, what happens? So we can add the skews also. We can take the advantage of skews, clock skew as well, sometimes to fix, to meet the timing. Next, we see a few examples of how we design synchronous circuits glitch free. So most of the time in digital designs, we may require, say, suppose the input is very simple example. Let's see a few simple example. We have a clock and say the input is an external input, say pulse, a handshaking signal is encountered. So we may have to extend it to further, say, maybe n clock cycle, or say one more extra clock cycle, so that say two interfaces are there. So one interface to next interface, say one interface to second interface, we are transferring a pulse. So that's a handshaking signal. So moment that handshaking signal is encountered, say second circuit should do some operation. So that's important of drawing timing. We need to have the timing when we design interface level. We need to draw the timing of timing between the two circuits, especially when we design the interfaces. So this is a very simple example. So this is how the timing is required. So how to design a circuit for this. So one is our conventional way. From timing, we can draw the FSM, finite state machine. Then from FSM, we can derive the circuit. So two types of FSMs are there, Mealy or Moore FSM. Or from experience, we'll be by looking at the waveform, say this requires a delay, basically a flop we require. D, Q. So if you have the timing knowledge, by looking at the timing itself, we can say I require a delay flop to generate a one clock cycle delay. So the input is say input is x, and if the x, suppose I am feeding to the flop, so assume this is synchronous input, so at this postage x won't be some x would be sampled as 0, and by next postage x would be sampled as 1, then after TPD, so this is a TPD, output would be high, and again next x is 0, so output would go to low. So now by looking at this, say I generated a delayed waveform. Next, what is the requirement? So if I now OR the input and the flop output, if I OR the input and flop output, the output would be something like this. So by looking at the timing diagram, so based on the interface, whatever we design requirement, we need to draw the timing. Then by looking at the timing diagram, we need to identify which circuit is required. So it's a very simple timing. Say by looking at the input is say extended to one more clock cycle. So definitely I need to delay this input for one more clock cycle, and if you what operation we need to do to generate this, so if you OR it, we will be getting the output. So very simple, D clock and input is D. So X is feeding to the input D, and both if we OR, the output is Y. Or you can draw the FSM, finite state machine, by looking at this. Say input is X. By looking at this timing, say two states are required, S0 and S1. Then if X is say 0, so a state is nothing but the, so finite state machine designs are very, very important when we do with the digital design, digital timing also. So state is nothing but the output of a flop is called the state Q, and input of the flop is called the next state always. Output of the flop is called the state and input is called the next state. So now S0 initial state input is 0, same, so X is 0, output is also 0 only, and moment X is 1, input is 1, output would be 1, but state will be changing after the next clock period only. So input is 1, immediately input is 1, input is equal to 0, output is 0, so input is equal to 1 means output also would be 1, then state would be changing to S1. Then if it is 1, it would be there itself, and if it is 0, output will continue to 1 for one clock cycle, then it goes to next state. So it's a symbol, so we can draw the FSM also, or we can design the circuit from the timing. So now what happens, this circuit, see, if we have the input, if there is a hazard, static, say one hazard at the input X, so we have delayed it If you delay it, output would be like this. And if you OR this, again the hazard or glitch will propagate to the next internal circuit of the next interface. By interface, it will propagate to the next internal, our say circuit 2. So as I mentioned, again, hazards maximum we need to try to avoid. Suppose there is an hazard is coming or glitch is coming due to transition. If you do this kind of design, say, immediately the hazard will be propagating to the next level of circuit as well. So what to do? So we need to again, so if you see this timing, say after the input is flopped, means synchronized to the circuit 2, then output is glitch-free. So we can use a D flop Q and a clock. So this output now again, so this, let's use a D flop first, then take this. Second flop is not required. Then OR it. So in this case, what happens, how the timing would be? Okay, if you have the input, we have the clock. The first flop output would be something like this. So it would be sampled, say, at this passage. And after TPD, we get the output. Then second flop output, again this would be, say, this at this posit it is 0, would be sampled here and would be delayed by one more clock cycle. So now we are ORing this output and this output. So when we OR these two output, we will be getting a waveform like this. So as compared to the first waveform, see here, there is a the glitch or hazard, whatever is there, that is propagated to the second circuit. But if you add a flop, means register, always let's suppose you are registering the input and then performing our operation. Disadvantage is there is a one clock delay. One clock delay is here, it is happening. One clock delay. But the output is glitch free, means it is very clear. So always in circuit design, whenever we are transferring a output to this next level of input, we have to register it and send it always. Any combo output, we should not transfer as such. So if you combo output, if you are transferring as such, the timing, say as we saw, timing of or frequency of operation of a circuit is from one flop output to next flop input, one flop input to next flop input. So flop to flop is the timing input. So this input, and we have a combo path and next flop input. So when we have a circuit, so say this will operate at say 200 megahertz, and another circuit that will operate, that suppose that is also operating at 200 megahertz. And if we are transferring a combo, say output from here to here, say combo output, then when we integrate these two modules, whatever the glitch or that will propagate into this glitch produced by this combo or any, suppose any hazard or this, that will propagate to the second module also. Other than that, when we integrate these two, the timing path, now timing path is from say this flop input to next flop input, or suppose here any combo logic, that combo logic to next flop input. So frequency, when we together integrate two modules, frequency of operation may come down. So that is also another issue. So always better to register the output. So let's register the output always and send it to the next module. So any combo logic is here, whatever, register it and send it, so that when we are taking it to the next level, it is always synchronized and frequency of operation also will not affect. So this kind of design is called, this kind of state machine is called Moore machine, where input is, where output is a function of, so in this case, if you see in this case, output Y is a function of flop outputs only, or flop means states, present states only. So that means this flop output and this flop output. So based on this flop outputs only, the output Y is derived. But earlier case, the outputs are derived, the output is derived as a function of external input and the flop output. So whatever the hazard or glitch in the external input, that also would propagate in this case. So this is called Miele FSM design, and other style of FSM is called the Moore FSM design. So when we design any digital logic, as timing is concerned, it is better to design Moore FSM. Main advantages, it would, the circuit would be more hazard or glitch free. That as timing aspect, that is always better. So if you see the summary of timing, so today we discussed very simple timing. Knowledge in timing is essential for digital designers. Design should be glitch free. And detailed timing, we'll discuss in detailed timing, like multi-path, false path analysis, multiple path analysis, static timing analysis basics, all we'll discuss in a detailed class. So today we discussed very simple timing fundamentals, starting from the hazards in combination, how a hazard will cause when we design a digital circuit. Finally, how a hazard will propagate or cause into the output of the combo circuit, and the hazards are very dangerous. There shouldn't be hazard when we design a circuit, should be glitch free, because hazards will cause unwanted frequency radiation, frequency emissions, and that in turn will spoil our circuit behavior. and the flops timing, TPD, setup time, what is setup time, what is hold time, and how to decide the frequency of a circuit, how to draw the timing. And advantage of clock skew, and how to design a synchronous circuit. So always we have to design glitch-free synchronous. So better, always better to follow more FSM-based design. So summary is, knowledge in timing is essential for digital designers. Design should be glitch-free. Detailed timing we will cover next, like multipath, false path, meta stability issues. When we design, when there are setup and hold time violations. So any doubt now we can discuss, any clarifications?
Yeah, thank you, sir. So you, someone is asking, please repeat clock skew timing diagram and solving the issue.
Okay, clock skew.
Timing and timing diagram and solving the issue. How we will solve the timing, clock timing. May I know who is that? It is written admin here. Can you just unmute yourself and ask? That's Sweta. Sweta, you are from? Okay. Sweta from Nilit. Okay.
So in this case, clock, this example we saw, TPD is 4 nanosecond, T setup, TPD is 4 nanosecond, T inverter is 5, T setup is 6, T hold is 3, T skew also 3. So I will just again draw the timing. TPD four, TPD is 4 now. TPD is 4, T inverter is 5. Setup hold skew. TPD, T inverter 5, T hold 3, T TPD, T inverter C set. T skew is equal to 3. And T setup is 6 nanosecond. So this is the timing, TPD, T inverter, T hold, T skew, T setup. So if you see the clock one, so we need to see the two flops are here. Input is a X, so this is D zero, X is coming, Q zero, and there is an inverter, a combo pass symbol inverter, D one, Q1. So now if you see the moment input is changing, X is changing, after TPD, say X is sampled here, after TPD, we will be getting the output Q0. So Q0 will be toggling or changing after TPD, once input X is changing. Then again, the inverter output, this output would be changing after T inverter. So this is, say, TPD is 4 nanosecond, T inverter is 5 nanosecond. So next, if the input, output of the inverter or input of the second flop, so that should satisfy the setup of setup of the second flop. Say setup is, T setup is. So that means before the setup, the inverter should toggle. So after that, there should not be any change. So inverter, suppose it is changing within the setup window of this, setup violation will occur. So now clock frequency is, say, TPD plus T inverter plus T setup. So T setup is 6 nanosecond. So now I said there is a positive skew, not negative. So positive skew means clock will be delayed like this. Say 3 nanosecond delayed. So because of this clock delay, now we are getting an extra Marcet. Always when we analyze the timing path, as we discussed, it is input of the flop to next input of the flop. That is the path. So input to input. So this D0 to next D1. So now we assume the clock is sourced here, and moment it reaches the second flop, it is delayed by 3 more clock cycles, 3 nanosecond delay. So because of this 3 nanosecond delay, now we are getting a set, because now we are checking with respect to the setup window. Now it is with respect to the clock, delayed clock. We are getting a 3 nanosecond margin here now. So that means what we can do, we can reduce this clock, say like this, because of, if you reduce it clearly, we get the clock within the setup window of the second flop. So that in turn helped us, that means in turn helped us to reduce the time period of this clock, say from TPD plus T inverter means 9 plus 15 nanosecond to say 12 nanosecond, means reduced by 3. So that means we are getting an improvement, means 1 by 15 nanosecond, now it frequency has become 1 by 12 nanosecond. Is it clear this timing? You can just once again draw and practice.
Any other queries from any other participants? Can get some basic on timing constraint like input delay, output delay, multi-cycle. Atul, I hope the detailed thing like multi-cycle paths and all are explained in the one more session is there on next week, that is on Saturday. So you can just go through our website and find the link for that. Retiming, multi-cycle paths, etc. are explained in that session. I hope that will be explained there. So if you wish to join, you can join that session very well. You can have
some so other basic timing constraints. We need to give input to from IO pin or input to our logic, then logic to logic is the clock, this path flop input to the next flop input, then flop output to next again IO delay, input delay, output delay, and this clock delay. These three are main constraints when we give. Then other than that, if any path is multi-cycle, then we need to say we as per this timing we saw input to input, so that is only one clock cycle. If that path is multi-cycle as per our design, we need to say that is multi-cycle path. And similarly, any asynchronous input out there, that we need to say it is false path. So like a clock domain transfer, we need to take care designing the clock, what are the design constraints we need to put in the clock domain, that we need to say it's false path. Otherwise that encounter into this normal path and say frequency or setup or all those kind of violations. So those kind of constraints we can give when we design the FPGAs or ASIC.
Okay, Atul, you are asking about the timing constraints in the tool, right? So, okay, I hope Sarah's answered it. So what about negative
tool, any constraints? If you want, we can give the script now, our script, how we generate.
Yeah, we can give the sample script. Atul, you can approach us. We will give you the sample script for static timing analysis, which we have performed for our IC, which contains all basic input delay, output delay, how we can tackle the multi-path, multi-cycles, etc. So that you can approach us. Negative skew? Some question from negative about negative skew.
Negative skew means clock will be advanced. So clock is advanced means again, frequency, we need to add that. Like here, positive means we subtract it. There, we need to add it. So that we, when we are designing the clock management circuits, we need to see which path requires an active way, whether we need to advance the clock. So some path we may need to advance the clock for proper sampling of the data. In that case, negative skew comes.
Okay. Some more question from Digvijay. He explained how glitch occurred in last example. Which example is it on the screen, Digvijay? Which is on the screen?
This example, static zero.
He's telling no. Digvijay, can you unmute yourself and talk? Are you there? He's asking about FSM question.
How glitch occurs? So glitch, suppose glitch is occurring, that's all.
No, some random glitch is occurring.
That would be cleared by more FSM design.
Okay. Is it clear, Digvijay?
Okay. This glitch is static time, that static one hazard output we are taking into
a circuit. Other question, sir, some other question from Sam Suresh. What will happen when we change frequency during time, whole time violations? I think frequency will not help it.
Frequency will not help it. That's an example we saw. This simple example you can just again analyze. Frequency, if we change, because this whole time analysis is coming with respect to the edge. So edge, whatever we change, no issue. Change will happen, affect. So we need to optimize the, here we need to add two more inverters in this case, means that timing path we need to. Data path we need to optimize.
Is that clear, Sam? Is it clear, Sam? Okay. Any other questions? So, sir, we have Mr. Raghunath from ISRO. We were just chatting.
Hello,
Raghu, any questions, Raghunath? Sir, any questions from your side?
Hello.
Raghu, are you there?